Okay. Okay, I have a great pleasure to introduce Professor Maria Kuznetsova from Saratov State University. She will talk about inverse problem for the Sturmmobile operators with frozen argument. So Professor Kuznetsova, please tell us your paper.
I am grateful to the organizers for the invitation to give a lecture. The topic of the lecture is inverse problem for the Sturmmobile operators with frozen argument. So we study the boundary value problem 1, 2, as written on the slide, in which we have the potential Q is from L2, 0 pi, and A is some fixed point from the segment 0 pi. In equation 1, we have the value y of A, the value in some fixed point A, and in 2, we have 4 types of the boundary conditions. Equation 1 belongs to the class of the so-called logit equations, which have applications in mathematics, physics, and various areas. For example, equation 1 appears in modeling heat conduction in a rod with an interior heat source described by the function Q of X and having the power proportional to the temperature at some fixed point. You can see this application and some others in the paper of Krau, which is cited at the bottom of the slide. The next, let us introduce the characteristic function. We introduce the functions S and C as solutions of equation 1 under the initial conditions of sine and cosine type at the point A. Then we have that the eigenvalues of boundary value problem 1, 2 with our frozen argument coincide with the zeros of the characteristic function delta of lambda. And the spectrum of boundary value problem 1, 2 coincides with zeros of this function, denote the eigenvalues as lambda n, and we take each eigenvalue as much time times as his multiplicity as zero. And further, we consider inverse problem 1 for the boundary value problem 1, 2. Given spectrum lambda n, find Q of X. Further, the most complete results in the inverse spectral theory in the inverse problems theory have been obtained for the classical Sturmmobile operators. You can see classical results in the works from 2 up to 4. We mentioned that operators with frozen argument are non-local. And by this reason, the classical methods of the inverse problems theory do not work for these operators. Recently, however, in connection with numerous applications, there appeared a considerable interest in inverse problems for non-local operators, including integral differential operators and operators with delay. Let us return to inverse problem 1. It was addressed in a series of works. In the works from 5 up to 7, the case of rational frozen argument was studied from the less general case to the more general one. And the most general case was studied in the work 7. The work 8 is devoted to the case of rational frozen argument. Further, we also should mention recent work of Bondarenko. It devoted to a second order difference equation with frozen argument And this equation was considered as a discrete approximation of continuous equation one with frozen argument. The relationship between the eigenvalues of the continuous problem and its finite difference approximation was established, this relation was used for development of a numerical algorithm for inverse problem one. Further, let us consider a rational case. Before we should note that there were two different approaches to inverse problem one, depending on whether the ratio of A and P was rational or it was irrational. First, we consider the rational case when A over pi can be written as J over K, where J and K are natural numbers and they are mutually prime. And we also introduce the constant B, pi over K. The most general case was studied in the ROC 7 joint with Sergei Buterin. And further, we provide some results from this work. Concerning the method of solution for inverse problem, by specific of rational case, inverse problem one is reduced to the main equation three, where W of t, the function on the left of this equation, can be found from the characteristic function. And the characteristic function in turn can be constructed as an infinite product in which we substitute eigenvalues. So we know W of t in this equation Q and R are also known operators, which are bijective. And in this equation, we also have the matrix A of order K. The matrix A of order K has the structure as written on the slide. It has non-zero elements only on four diagonals. And on each diagonal, there are the same elements. And further, in this equation three, we should find the potential Q. Note that the function Q is reconstructed uniquely if and only if the determinant of A is non-zero. So we have the question with when this determinant is not zero. The work seven, it was proved that the determinant of the matrix A is given by the formula four. And for the proof of this theorem, we studied the properties of the graph with two K vertices corresponding to the non-zero elements of A. Two vertices of this graph are connected by edge if the corresponding elements from the matrix A are in the same row or column. We also present an article with another interesting method for computing determinant of A based on Chebyshev's polynomials. It is the work 10. It is also a recent work. From the theorem 1.1 for the determinant, we obtain a classification of rational cases. The degenerate cases are written in the formula 5. In these cases, the determinant of A is zero and the potential Q is not recovered uniquely. The other cases are non-degenerate. And they are listed in formula 6. In this case, in these cases, the determinant of A is not zero, and the potential Q is recovered uniquely. The uniqueness theorem, it was also proved, the theorem 1.2. In non-degenerate case, we have the following. If lambda n equals tilde lambda n, then Q equals tilde Q. And this means that the spectrum uniquely determines the potential in degenerate case. We should indicate additional information for the uniqueness of recovery. And as such information, we consider the operator K acting in the space L2, 0b. And we assume that such operator satisfies the conditions that I plus K is invertible, I is identity operator, and it also satisfies formula 7. It acts on the potentials in such ways that indicated in the formula 7. Then we have, if we know such operator K, we have that the equality lambda n equals tilde lambda n yields Q equals tilde Q. We note that the proof of the theorem is constructive and gives also an algorithm. We also consider the following remark in the degenerate case. One can take the constant operator K such that for all functions F in L2 0b, K of F is the same function G. Indicating such operator K corresponds to a priori specification of Q on the subinterval of the length B. We also note that varying G in L2 0b, one can obtain all isospectral potentials in the degenerate case. The next result is necessary and sufficient conditions. They are presented in theorem 1.3. Formulation of the theorem. Eigenvalues lambda n satisfy asymptotic formula 8. However, if the case is degenerate, one should impose one of the degeneration conditions. The degeneration conditions are listed under Roman numerals. They mean that each case eigenvalue degenerates. It doesn't depend on the potential Q and coincides with the eigenvalue of a trivial boundary value problem, which means trivial when the potential is zero. And we note that the theorem gives also not necessary conditions, but also sufficient conditions. We also proved that. Further, we consider irrational case. In irrational case, results were obtained in the work 8. In the irrational case, one cannot obtain the main equation 3, as it was in the rational case. However, the information on Q can be obtained in a different way. For definiteness, we consider the case of the Dirichlet boundary conditions. We have a formula 9 for the characteristic function, and we note that since a over pi is irrational, the functions sine rho pi minus a and sine rho a do not have common zeros. So one can substitute these zeros into the characteristic functions, characteristic function, and find the coefficients of the function q with respect to basis sine pi n over a t. Is not good. On the segment from a to pi, coefficients of q with respect to basis sine pi a n over pi minus a pi minus t. And then the function q can be reconstructed uniquely separately on each of two segments from zero to a and from a to p to pi. This yields theorem 1.4. The formulation of the theorem in the irrational case, if lambda n equals tilde lambda n, then two potentials are also equal. This means that the spectrum uniquely determines the potential in irrational case. Moreover, in this work, an algorithm for solving inverse problem one was obtained. However, the question of the spectrum characterization was left open. The method suggested in it does not allow obtaining necessary and sufficient conditions for solvability of the inverse problem, as it was done in it for the rational case. We suggest a new unified approach studying both irrational and rational cases, which allows us to cross the question of necessary and sufficient conditions. This method was published in the works 11 and 12. The work 11 is a thesis of Yufa Autumn Mathematical School. And further, we present these results. For convenience, we introduce the notations which allow us to consider all possible boundary conditions. These notations are pi mu. It is the function sine or cosine, depending on mu, and Zn. Zn in square is the 10 in square are the zeros of the main part of the characteristic function. Further, the key point of the new approach is formula 10. It establishes a relationship between the values of the characteristic function and Fourier and the Fourier coefficients of function q with respect to basis pi alpha, the 10 t. We denote omega is the set of indices m such that phi a alpha a the term is zero. It is a multiplier in the formula 10 between the Fourier coefficient. For indices in omega, we have that delta of the 10 in square is zero, and the 10 in square is an eigenvalue. If indice n is not in omega, formula 10 determines the relation between the values of the characteristic function and the corresponding Fourier coefficient with respect to the orthogonal trigonometric basis pi alpha the term t. I remind that phi alpha is sine or cosine. And in 12, it was theorem 2.1 was proved. for an arbitrary sequence lambda n of complex numbers to be the spectrum of the boundary value problem 1, 2, which is necessary and sufficient to satisfy the asymptotic formula 11. We see in this formula that n in square is the main part. And the residue member is consists of two parts. There is a new n is the sequence from L2 and phi alpha of A is a 10. It can be sometimes zero or arbitrarily close to zero. However, this multiplier is always bounded. Next. The necessity part is obtained in a standard way, including Taylor expansions for trigonometric functions. Let us discuss the proof of sufficiency. Assume that arbitrary sequence lambda k satisfying our asymptotic formula 11 is given. And then we can construct potential q such that a boundary value problem with such a potential has eigenvalues lambda k. For this purpose, we construct infinite product pi of lambda containing this lambda k. And further, we prove, we construct the C, the point three. We construct the function q satisfying the formula 12, such that its Fourier coefficients are determined by this product. And we prove that by asymptotics, such function q NL2 exists. And further, using asymptotics and the theory of entire functions, we prove that delta of lambda equals pi of lambda. Delta of lambda is a characteristic function of the boundary value problem 1, 2 with the constructed Q. And so we obtain that the given lambda K coincides with the eigenvalues for the boundary value problem 1, 2 with the Q satisfying 12. And the sufficiency is proved. From the proof of theorem 2.1, it follows that the potentials Q corresponding to one of the same spectrum have the same Fourier coefficients, which are defined by formula 12. However, for n in omega, the coefficients Xn with respect to this basis may differ. Thus, the potential Q is uniquely recovered given the spectrum lambda n and the sequence of the Fourier coefficients Xn when the indice n is in omega. And we obtain the theorem 2.2. Let tilde lambda n be the spectrum of the boundary value problem 1, 2 with another potential tilde q, and tilde Xn its Fourier coefficients when indice n is in omega. If two spectra are equal and the corresponding coefficients Xn and tilde Xn are equal, then both potentials coincide. Further, let us discuss asymptotics 11. For definiteness, we consider the case of the Dirichlet boundary conditions. Then our formula 11 coincides with 13. The main part is n in square, and residue member is kappa n with sine of na. And consider rational and irrational cases. First case is rational, a over pi is j over k. And then we have that each case eigenvalue degenerates by the reason that sine of kma is zero. It contains entire number of pi and then turns zero. And then lambda with the number km is a trivial eigenvalue km in square. And also note that the sequence sine na has only a finite number of different members and it contains zero. Then formula 13 is equivalent to the conditions of theorem 1.3 containing necessary and sufficient conditions on the spectrum. And in the rational case, we have that our theorem 2.1 and theorem 1.3 give the same conditions. And second, if a over pi is irrational, sine of na never turns zero. However, the sequence of sine na has members arbitrarily close to zero. And the multiplier sine of na in the formula 13 cannot be reduced. Further, after submitting these results to the journal, the author became aware about the work of Novosevich and Grinev, the work 16. They considered the Sturm-Liouville operator with Poisson argument as one-dimensional perturbation of the self-adjoint operator A of y minus y, the second derivative, and they approach essentially relies on the self-adjointness of the operator A. By this reason, it is inapplicable to for studying the Sturm-Liouville operator with Poisson argument of more general form L of Y. So we don't have not only minus Y two derivatives and Y of A Q of X, but also additional member Y of X, P of X, if the function P is complex value. At the same time, the approach offered here doesn't depend on the self-adjointness and it can be generalized for to studying the inverse problem of recovering Q by the spectrum of Ly with a known P. Let us present generalization. And we should consider the boundary value problem 14, 15. For definiteness, we consider Dirichlet boundary conditions. There are the boundary conditions can be treated in the same way. And the functions P and Q can be a complex valued functions in L2. And A, as before, a fixed point from the segment. We use the same notations that lambda n are eigenvalues of these boundary value problems, boundary value problem. And we denote by delta of lambda the characteristic function for 14, 15. And we study inverse problem one if the function p is known. We could introduce notations pi and g, introduce them as solutions of equation 16, the classical Sturm-Liouville equation, under sine type initial conditions. For pi, we impose them at the point A, and for g, we impose them at the left end of the segment. We denote by lambda n zero the eigenvalues of the boundary value problem for 16 with the Dirichlet boundary conditions. And it is known that this eigenvalue satisfies asymptotics written on the slide. lambda n zero is n in square, and the average of the function p, and the residue member from L2. We consider these values, lambda n zero, because they play the same role as the tangent square, which were equal n in square did in the previous case when p was zero. However, the principal difference is that lambda n zero can be multiple, and we have to work with multiple values. We denote by mn the multiplicities of lambda n zero, and introduce other notations which are convenient for working with multiple values. We introduce the set of indices with of unique elements in the sequence lambda k zero. Denote this set S, and we also assume that equal numbers in the sequence follow each other, as written at the bottom of the slide. So we the next step is to obtain an analog of formula 10. It is formula 17. We should consider not only the values of delta at the lambda n zero, but also the derivatives of the corresponding order, of the order corresponding to the multiplicity of lambda n zero. And further, from this formula, we obtain the first part of theorem 3.1. First part. Let lambda n zero be zero of the function phi of pi lambda of multiplicity kn. Then the multiplicity of lambda n zero as an eigenvalue of the boundary value problem 14, 15 with a frozen argument is not less than the minimum of two numbers mn and kn. And the second part of this theorem is obtained in a standard way, including asymptotics for all sufficiently large n. N should such that all multiplicities mn are equal one. The following asymptotics hold. And the asymptotics lambda n is lambda n zero plus residue member. And as before, we have that the sequence kappa n is L2 sequence, and the multiplier n pi of pi lambda n zero is bounded multiplier. However, it can be zero or arbitrarily close to zero. The next, we formulated conditions on the sequence lambda n, and further, we provide a uniqueness theorem. For this, we need a lemma. Denote the functions g, n plus nu, the functions of t, such as in the way such that it, they are derivatives of the function g, t of lambda n zero, of the order corresponding to the multiplicity of lambda n zero. And for sufficiently large n, it is, there is no derivatives, only a substitution of lambda n zero. And it is known that this system composed of jk is a Ries basis in L2. We consider this sequence because from formula 17, we can determine the coefficients of the function q with respect to this basis. In some cases when the multiplier before this coefficient is not zero. This gives us theorem 3.2. First part, let the multiplier pi of pi lambda n zero is not zero. Then we have if lambda n equals lambda n tilde, then two potentials also coincide. And the second part, another situation when phi of phi lambda n zero can be zero, then we cannot reconstruct Q uniquely only by spectrum. There exist different potentials Q and tilde Q such that their spectra coincide. And in this situation, for uniqueness of recovery, one should determine additionally the coefficients with respect to the basis. And among all coefficients, the number of these coefficients is determined by the multiplicity of lambda n zero as zero of the function of pi lambda n zero. And pi, this result was the last. I finished my report and thank you for attention.
Professor Kuznetsova, thank you very much for your presentation. There are a lot of results, a lot of recently published papers. So it's time for discussion. Do you have any answers and comments, questions?
May I ask some questions?
Yes.
Okay.
First, about this last result. Do I correctly understand that you have this asymptotics and you have the uniqueness theorem, right?
Yes.
Don't you have the spectrum characterization?
I think that it can be proved as in the second section of my report by the same method as I presented.
Yes, but I think you should say something about the eigenvalues for sufficiently small n's.
For sufficiently small? For sufficiently small, we have the part one.
Do you guess that these two conditions are necessary and sufficient?
Yes, I guess that.
The next question, do you have a constructive solution?
In the last part of presentation?
Yes.
Yes, I have, but I did not present algorithms in my presentation.
But the main idea is the same as in your previous
one. Yes, substitute zeros of the main part of the characteristic function.
Okay, thank you. And I also have a question about this paper by Tsai and co-authors, which was recently published.
Probably Sergei Buterin will
yes,
answer.
Maybe you, Maria, maybe the other author, the authors of this paper could explain.
Yes,
what is the principal novelty of the results of this paper comparing with the previous results?
The new is what it was established a relation between.
I don't hear you.
Yes. Yes, I understand.
Is it to me or to whom?
To Maria.
To Maria.
Yes, I understand. There was established a new relation between the determinant of A and the Tibyshev's polynomial. And results are the same as in the paper 7 this year.
So this paper provides a new method to obtain the same results for the rational case in which we're already right?
Yes.
Sergei,
yes,
is it
I understood.
There is some novelty?
No, the main result of that paper is the connection, actually the connection between between the matrices A and the Tibyshev polynomials. But this also gives alternative algorithm and it gives also some another algorithm for constructing isospectral potentials. So this connection allows to construct them directly.
Mm. So in the previous papers, there were only theorems that such potential exist, such potentials exist. But in this paper, you have a direct method to construct them.
There were theorems in previous papers how to construct such potentials. For example, there was such algorithm. For example, you have some algorithm for constructing the potential. And on a certain step of this algorithm, you should take all possible functions on some small interval. And when this function range over this L2 on this small interval, then the resulting potential range over all isospectral potentials. So some in such a way. But in that paper, there is, as I remember, just direct formula using Chebyshev polynomials.
Thank you. I also have a question. Have you studied the Robin boundary conditions?
No.
No, I studied, but I studied very many things already, but it's not published yet.
Okay, thank you.
But if you know about Robin boundary conditions, the picture will be slightly
analogous.
Yes, analogous, but there will be some difficulties. So some differences.
Yes, I see. Maybe the situation will be in some sense similar to this last problem told by Maria today.
You mean with another function?
Yes, when you have not just sines and cosines, but when you have some combinations of sines and cosines. Yes, it will be similar to this.
You mean that the function phi will be a combination of sine and cosine?
Yes.
It would be a function. I didn't check, but I'm sure it must be a function like we usually denote by phi that satisfies one Robin boundary condition.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? Okay, if you don't have any questions, we can finish today's session. Once again, thank you very much, Professor Kuznetsova, and we will see in 15 days. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the interesting talk.